I've just been just overwhelmed. I really have. My wife and I have wept and cried today and thinking about today and what this day means. It's hard to believe. We're celebrating 8 years. It's hard to believe. The Lord has blessed us and guided us and directed us and provided. We had folks in here yesterday that don't come to church here, just visiting, looking around, but they just went on and on about the building. It thrills my heart to tell them what God's doing here. Yes. And how the Lord's provided and roofing and all the things God's provided. And it's just amazing. We've given the glory and honor for it. Just a little while, we're going to hurry along through the service, but just a little while, we're going to show a video of where we started and how we got started and folks have started and all that kind of thing. I love those remembrance. We need to remember more. And today, I trust, will be a day of remembrance. And very, very glad that you're here. Very glad, especially for my home pastor being here. It's a thrilling day for me. It really is. This is the fellow that led me to the Lord. I got so much to talk to you about in just a minute. But he and his dear wife have been faithful to the Lord so many years. And Miss Susan driving up, bringing them up. And my mother coming up. Appreciate her being here. But appreciate our visitors being here. God bless you for being here. And traveled up. Folks still coming in. We appreciate that very much. Let's ask the Lord's blessing. We're going to sing. And we'll jump right into this. Let's stand, if you will. Let's go to the Lord's throne together as a church family, church body. And we'll pray and ask the Lord to get in this thing that he might bless and guide us. Father, we do bow our heads. Lord, I'm overwhelmed this morning with gratitude that you've been so kind and so gracious and so loving and so tender. Lord, I thank you for this day and what it represents and what it does for me in my own heart to have my dear pastor here that told me the greatest news I'd ever heard in my life, the gospel, the death, the burial, the resurrection, to be saved, to know the Lord Jesus as my Savior, to have a heaven, a home in heaven, to have my sins forgiven, to be clean before God. What a tremendous, tremendous thought. I'm so thankful for that. So thankful for our folks that are here today to celebrate this wonderful day, it being 8 years. And we'd ask, Lord, that you do a great work in our midst today. Bless Brother Jim as he stands here in just a moment to preach the Word of God as he's done so many times in the years. I am so faithful. Would you bless him? Would he know and understand the anointing of the Holy Ghost of God? May he have an unction from the Holy One today to preach the gospel and preach the scripture as it is, as we are, that we might come to know you. If there's someone in this building that's never truly trusted the Lord Jesus as their Savior, may today be the day that they be born again. Maybe there be some Christian that's discouraged that's come in. May they be lifted and encouraged today. Again, as we go through this service, help us put our mind upon you. Guide us and direct us. We'll be careful to thank you in advance. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, I want to take just a minute and testify a little bit about what this day means to me. It means more to me than just 8 years of church. It means salvation and Jesus dying for me. I want to take just a minute. Brother Jim's going to preach here in just a minute. We'll do some of the other stuff here in just a moment. But I'm thrilled that he's here. I really am. His dear wife, I want to try to give you an idea of what this dear man and his dear wife mean to my wife and I. He pastors the Victor Baptist Church in Shelbyville, Tennessee. He's been pastor there. We'll be pastor 54 years in March. Pastor the same church for 53 years. Amazing. Charity's dad, before she was born, was lost, of course, and he got saved just shortly after she was born and started attending Victor Baptist Church faithfully. She was just a small baby. And then, of course, that put Charity being under his ministry as a young girl, young child. She got saved at 5 years old under the ministry at Victor Baptist Church. Her dad and mom are still faithful there. My mom's faithful there. Family. But Calvin and growing up there, and of course putting his children there, they get saved at Victor Baptist and Brother Jim. That put her under his ministry all of her life. growing up in a Christian home because of a strong Bible preaching church. And then you fast forward to 1990, my brother got saved at Victor Baptist Church under the influence of Rusty Tedder, which is Brother Jim and Miss Barbara's son. Rusty and Shane Bibbins worked with my brother and encouraged my brother to go to church. My brother got saved at Victor Baptist Church. I went to see him baptized when I was 15, first time I'd ever been in church. Went to Victor Baptist Church. My brother's in heaven because of this man.
Amen.
And so you can see where I'm going with this. My heart's indebted to him. And then you go fast forward a bit more in 1998, as Brother Chuck said, he preached the gospel, and I walked the aisle at Victor Baptist Church and got saved.
Hey.
Walked the aisle, and on the second step of the Victor Baptist Church, gave my heart to Christ.
Hey.
I was born again by the Spirit of God. And in 1999, I met my wife at Victory, and which was a great day. And met her. 1999, Brother Jim counseled us and married us July 1st, 2000. Matter of fact, a few days, we'll celebrate 15 years. And so that's 1999, and that's 2000. And in 2002, God called me to preach out of his ministry. And under his advice and direction, I came to him and told him I was called to preach. And he directed me, felt like he knew my background, knew who I was, and so I felt that would help be helpful to me since I was called to preach to go to school, get some training, get some education in the ministry, study the Bible for a concentrated amount of time. And so he said, come back tonight and I'll give you a list of colleges you can pray about, good colleges. So I did. I came back that night and he gave me a list. And on that list was one college. He was helping the brother out with it. But God directed me. God was in all that. Because 2006, we started the Twin City Baptist Church.
Amen.
God was in all that. You're sitting in the evidence of what God does. The Valley of One, brother. He told a story about the Valley of One. I'm telling you, you're your own Valley of One. And so there's been a benefit. God got the glory for all that's done here. It's stemming from that. And that's, we're not praising men, but God uses that.
Amen.
And that's what God does with Bill. I was preaching Sunday school this morning about the gospel. That's it. If we get the gospel to people, then lives are changed.
Yeah.
And so that led us to this very point in time. And I'm going to ask my wife to come along. She's got a couple of things she wants to say. I'm going to try to help her because I told her she'd be a super bowl. But she, of course, has spent her whole life at Victory, and she wants to say a few things by way of honoring dear pastor.
Maybe not. I used to think that since I didn't get saved out of a life of sin, that I didn't understand God's mercy. But now I realize that God in his mercy allowed me to be born in a Christian home with Christian I understand that God in his mercy led us to Victor Baptist Church under a pastor and a pastor's wife who have been faithful all of these years to teach us the truth. I understand that God in his mercy allowed me to meet my husband at church and has given us the chance to raise our own Christian home. I can look back over the years and testify that God has been merciful. We have a song that we want to play for you. If I could have written the words to this song, I would have written the exact thing they say. If I could have sang this song for you, I can't sing, or I would have sung it to you. But I pray that when you hear it, you understand how your life has changed.
God bless
you. First of all, the Bible's first lesson. The first Bible lesson, God's first Bible lesson. And then I'm going to talk to you about Christ's first miracle. And of course, one of them is in the Old Testament, but others in the New Testament. And so you get the outline, you can follow the scripture. Now, I'm going to read the scripture from my outline up here today. It's the last reason I gave you that. I won't be turning to the Bible, so I'll be reading the scripture rather fast. you can go home and study that it over, or you can leave it here and let somebody else handle it. But I prefer you to take it home with you and look on the scripture after we get through preaching here this morning, if you can't find it in the Bible as I'm preaching. God bless you. Thank you, Brother Todd, for allowing me to be here today. Appreciate it, buddy. Appreciate it. Let's pray. Father, we love you. Thank you for the opportunity of being in the house of God this morning. My heart's already been blessed, and I praise you, Lord. I praise you for the great work that you're doing here in this place. I praise you for these people here, God, that's serving the Lord Jesus Christ right here in Twin Cities. Ask the Lord blessings upon them. Ask the Lord blessings upon Brother Todd and his dear family and all the workers here. And Father, if there be anybody in this building today that's unsaved, I pray, Spirit of the living God, right now that you would begin to deal with their hearts. And Lord, that you would challenge every one of us that are saved, that we might leave here today better equipped to serve you and closer to the Lord than we were when we came. We thank you, Lord, for this opportunity. We ask you, Lord, to use us. We put ourselves in your hands now. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, and God's people said,
Amen.
Amen. I love the Bible prophecy. The Bible is the only book that has prophecy in it. There's other books that's got predictions in it. And sometimes those predictions might come true. But the Bible prophecy will come true every single time.
Yes.
The Bible said in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 19, we have a more sure word of prophecy. We have something that's sure in the prophecy that God's given us. Now listen, what do you do well? That you take heed to a light that shineth in a dark place until the day dawn. You know what? I believe the Holy Spirit speaking to me about that verse of Scripture. God said, I've given you prophecy in a dark day. Are we living in a dark day in America? I've never seen America deteriorate so fast. She's never been this way in the history of this nation. It's going down, folks. America's going down. And you're knowing what I'm talking about, and you will before the message is over. But God said this prophecy in the Bible is like a light that shineth in a dark place until the day dawn. That day that's going to dawn is the day of the Lord.
Amen.
Hallelujah. I'm looking forward to it. I've never prayed so much for the Lord to return as I have right now in my life.
Amen.
Even so, Lord Jesus, come back. Amen. I'm looking for that. Now, the Bible said concerning prophecy, the prophecy came not in verse 21. The prophecy came not, the Bible said, in old time, by man, but by holy men of God, the scripture said, as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. This Bible is a supernatural book.
Amen.
It's just a supernatural. It's Christ, it's God, it's the Holy Spirit. It is God's Word. It was in heaven before God ever brought it down here on earth.
Amen.
And the men of God that wrote the Bible wrote it exactly the way God had it in heaven.
Amen.
Somebody said Isaiah wrote it. Yeah, Isaiah wrote it. He put the words down, but God used Isaiah to do it. And he wrote it exactly the way God wanted it to be written. Now, we're going to talk about several verses of Scripture and prophecy. Are we living in the last days?
Yes, sir. Yes.
You know, it's good that God told us what it would be like, isn't it?
Yes.
We've got to say it in Victor Baptist. It's getting gloriously dark. Did you hear what I said? Gloriously dark. It's not just getting dark. It's glorious as far as a child of God's concerned. Because of the Bible prophecy. In the book of Matthew chapter 24, if you will turn down, there's several verses of Scripture we're going to read there. Matthew chapter 24, the very first thing, the disciples came to the Lord and said, what shall be the sign of thy coming to the end of the world? And the very first thing Jesus said in verse 4, there's going to be much deception. Much deception. Have you listened to the radio, the television lately? Have you listened to the folly that the preachers, so-called preachers, are putting out in the airwaves? God said much deception is going to come. Then he said in verse 6, there's going to be wars and rumors of wars. Have you listened to the news lately? Wars and rumors of wars. Hey, he wrote this 2,000 years ago, folks. And yet it's happening in today's headlines. But then he made another statement. He said, but the end is not yet. We can expect this to happen. But he said, we're getting close, but the end's not here yet. Then in verse 7, he said there's going to be famines, there's going to be pestilences, there's going to be earthquakes in diverse places. That's here, folks.
Yes.
That's here. Famines, pestilence. We've got diseases today that's never been known in the history of mankind. And the Bible said earthquakes almost, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of earthquakes occurring every single day on this planet. God said it's going to happen that way in the end time. Then he says in verse 8, these are the beginnings of sorrow. It's just something, hey, it's happening. And Jesus said, it's just beginning. You know what he's talking about? He's talking about ultimately the great tribulation period. Now, wait a minute. We're not going over here in the great tribulation period. We're out of here. He said, how do you know that, Brother Jim? Let me tell you how I know that. The great tribulation period is going to be God's wrath poured out upon this planet because of the rejection of the Lord Jesus Christ, and especially the nation of Israel. Now hear me. God's wrath cannot be poured out on us. Why? Because it was poured out on Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. He suffered what we ought to have. Thank God we'll never have to suffer that wrath of God. Isn't that glorious thought?
Yes,
praise the Lord for the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And the Bible said here, there's going to be earthquakes in diverse places. And he said, these are the beginnings of sorrow. And then he said in verse 12, he said that sin will abound. And then he said, the love of many shall wax cold. Where's the love today? God, have mercy on us today. Just like your pastor taught us this morning. We have an obligation to get the gospel out. But we look at the people as if they don't deserve the gospel. Love of many shall wax cold. Then if you go to Matthew chapter 25 and verse 6, the Bible says when all that begins to happen, there's going to be a midnight cry. What is the midnight cry? Behold, the bridegroom cometh. Are you listening to Bible preaching today? Are you listening good on the radio, the television? You know what the main subject is? The bridegroom's coming. The Lord Jesus Christ is coming. 2,000 years ago, he wrote that in the scripture. Hallelujah for the scripture. It is like a light in a dark day that blesses our soul. Am I preaching right?
Yes, amen.
Look at Luke chapter 17, verse 26, 27. The Bible says, as it were in the days of Noah, as it were in the days of Lot, so shall it be unto you. Let's go back to the days of Noah. Let's study a little bit about the days of Noah. What was going on in the days of Noah? The Bible said Noah was preaching for 120 years while the ark was preparing. 120 years, you know what he's preaching? He's preaching the judgment of God is coming. You know what the people were doing? They were stopping up their ears. He's a God of love. He's not going to judge us. But I tell you what, the judgment of God came. People are not listening to the Word of God today, just like they didn't listen to the Word of God in Noah's day. Then he said, as it were in the days of Lot. You know where Lot lived, was before the fire came to destroy him. He lived in a place called Sodom. You know what they were practicing? Same-sex marriage. Sodomy. Are you listening? Did it not shock you that America today has it on the law books that sodomy has to be recognized in this nation as a legitimate marriage? I told some of the men a few minutes ago, if a man and woman wants to live that way, that's their business. But they don't have to shove that down us.
Amen.
I mean, they're always talking about us shoving Christianity off or something. I've never heard the Supreme Court make a law that said you've got to be Christians and accept Christianity. But they just made a law that said you're going to have to accept sodomy and you're going to be in trouble with the government. As it were.
Amen to that.
Yes, sir.
You know what Lot's position was in Sodom? He was one of the judges. Do you hear what I said? He said at the gate.
Yes.
You know what Lot did in Sodom? It vexed his soul, but he accepted Sodom. He even called the Sodomites brethren. And the Bible said it vexed his righteous soul over the New Testament. Had it not been for the New Testament, we'd think Lot would be burning in hell. But he was a saved man. He was a judge. And he was accepted Sodom. As it were. So shall it be again before the coming of the Son of Man. The days of Lot, the days of Noah. Then in Luke chapter 21, verse 28, the Bible said, when these things, now listen, begin to come to pass, look up, lift up your heads, for your redemption draweth nigh. You know what it's talking about redemption? Talk about the redemption of these old bodies. My soul was redeemed when I got saved.
Amen.
But this body's not going to be redeemed until I get the new body.
Amen.
That's the redemption that he's talking about here in that verse of Scripture. And then the Bible goes ahead and in Luke chapter 21, verse 32, he mentions, talks about the fig tree budding. If you do a study, and I'm not going to do that this morning, but if you'll do a study real good in the Bible, we'll go back to the book of Jeremiah, and the Bible said these fig trees, this fig represents Israel. The fig tree's budding right now. 1948, you know what happened to Israel? They became a nation again. After over 2,000 years dispersed among the Gentiles, they became a nation again. Folks, that's a miracle within itself. We saw that. I saw that miracle. I saw that happen. Israel became a nation again. That fig tree began to bud. Now, wait a minute. Jesus said in Luke's Gospel 21, verse 32, verily, he says, verily, you better forget this, verily I say unto you, he said, this generation shall not pass away till all be fulfilled. What generation, Lord Jesus? The generation that was alive when the fig tree began to bud.
Yeah.
Now, I don't know how long that generation is going to be. I had one commentator. A commentator got up and said, that means a race of people. I said, good night, fella. God knows the difference between a race and a generation. He wrote the book.
Yes,
and if he said, this generation will not pass away, folks, we're living in the last generation, I believe, with all my heart and soul. According to Bible prophecy, as a light shining in a dark place until the day start dawn.
Amen.
You say, preacher, I'm discouraged. I'm not the least bit discouraged. I'm encouraged.
Amen.
I'm encouraged. Now let's get into our Bible study real quick. Let's study God's first Bible lesson. God's first Bible lesson. In 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 8, remember this verse. The Bible said, beloved, be not ignorant of this one day. That one day is with the Lord as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is one day. Now, can you remember what I just said? One day is with the Lord as 1,000 years. And 1,000 years is one day. One day is 1,000 years long, as far as Jesus is concerned. If one day is 1,000 years, Jesus has been in eternity only 2 days since he was here, according to God's time and date. Are you listening? One day with God is 1,000 earth years. And 1,000 earth years here is just one day in heaven. Now, you remember that verse of Scripture as we look into the Bible. Now go to the book of Genesis, please. First book of the Bible. Genesis chapter 1, and let's look at some Bible, God's first Bible lesson. I get excited every time I get into that verse, that chapter of the book of Genesis. Genesis chapter 1, verse 3, the Bible said, let us make life. Let there be life. Hey folks, listen. That life was not the planets, not the sun, not the moon, not the stars. That life is a supernatural life. The first life that God's going to mention is the light that brings salvation. Who is the true light that lighteth every man that cometh into the world? The Lord Jesus Christ. So when God said, let there be light, he said, the first thing you need to do is to get acquainted with the true light of the world. You know what he's saying? Get saved. Get to know the true light. It's not these lights. It's not the moon, the stars. It's not that. It's the light of the Lord Jesus Christ that shines into our soul. Hey, May 28, 1958, that happened to me. I meant to get this over in a hurry. If I take 2 minutes extra, will you be mad at me? In the 11th grade in high school, some Gideons walked into our high school and handed out a Gideon New Testament. Gideons did hand out New Testaments to 11th graders in high school. They handed them out to 5th graders. That year, the 11th grade got the New Testament. There's a young man sitting in front of me named John Tipple. When he got it, he looked around at me and said, I'm going to read this book all the way through. I thought of John Tipple again. I can't. I went home that night and read Matthew chapter 1. Next night, Matthew chapter 2. Next night, Matthew chapter 3. I read a chapter in the Bible as a lost sinner until I read the entire New Testament. Guess what the Holy Ghost did? Same thing that he did to that guy that was going down to Ethiopia. I had the Bible, but I didn't understand it. But the Holy Ghost of God was telling me, you're going to go to hell. You're lost. I was so religious back in those days, I'd read a chapter of the Bible, and then I'd pray this prayer. Now I lay me down to sleep. I pray the Lord must go with you. I didn't know beans about it, the plan of salvation. Then I pray what I learned in public school, David's prayer, that the words of my mouth, meditation of my heart, be accepted in my sight. And then I also learned in public school, Our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Amen.
We had Bible back in those days. Amen. We started every day off with Bible, and preachers would come and preach to us on Wednesday.
Amen.
I learned some Bible in public school. I saved my conscience. Read another chapter the next night. Holy Ghost of God convict me, and I'd go through the same rigmarole. And then a soul winner came to my house, knocked on the door. The first time somebody showed me Jesus in the gospel, I got saved.
Amen.
And my God bless her Methodist mama. The night I got saved, she got up and walked out of the room, came back in. The pastor looked at her and said, "Miss Taylor, are you saved?" She said, "I am now."
Amen.
And I was preaching, pastor of the church, and I was preaching one day, and I said, the first man I ever witnessed to was a black man. I got home, Daddy said, You messed up today. I said, "Why?" He said, "He wasn't the first man you ever witnessed to." I said, "What do you mean, Dad?" He said, "I was the first man you ever witnessed to." My dad was a truck driver, and he'd been up to New York. I'm not going into any details, but he almost lost control of his car, his truck coming down Moneta Mountain before the interstate was there. And he made God a promise. "Listen to me. You let me get back home, I'll get saved." And he said, by the time he got back home, he thought, "I'm just a good truck driver. I had everything under control." My mom and I picked him up at the truck terminal that night. And she said, "Something happened in your home last week." "What?" I said, "Your son got saved." My dad put his arm around me and started weeping like a baby. I thought, "What in the world is wrong with him? Crying because I got saved." She said, "That's not all. You've got a new wife." That night at the supper table, I didn't know how to witness. I didn't know anything about the Romans Road. I didn't even know anything about the Bible. I just sat and told my dad what God had done for me and his wife. You know what my dad did? He got up from the supper table, went out in the backyard, got down on his knees and said, "Lord, what you did for my wife and son, I want you to do it for me."
Amen.
We did the strangest thing next Sunday. We went to church.
Amen.
I hadn't been to church 5 times in my entire life. And we did even a stranger thing this following Sunday. We got baptized. Hallelujah. My dad said, "I'm the first man you ever witnessed to after you got saved." Got saved on Thursday night. Listen to me. He got saved on Saturday night. Just go tell what God did for you. If you don't know the Bible, just tell them what God did for you. I don't. That's the life. And then the next thing I want you to notice in Genesis chapter verse 6, the Bible said, on the second day, God divided the waters from the waters. After salvation comes separation. A Christian is not separated, is not going to do much for Christ. Got saved, verse 1, the light of the Lord. And in verse 6, separation. And then you go down to verse 3. And in verse 3, the Bible said, they begin to bear fruit. Brought forth fruit after their time. Follow me. Salvation, separation, soul winning. Right here in the Bible. The first Bible lesson God gave on the 7 days of creation. Then you go to the fourth day. You go to the fourth day. You know what God did on the fourth day? He created the sun, the moon, the stars. On the fourth day. On the fourth day. You remember that verse I told you to remember a while ago in Peter? Where God said, "One day is with the Lord as 1,000 years, 1,000 years is one day." How many of you remember that verse? Let's see your hands. That's what it's saying. One day's 1,000 years. That for you that didn't remember, 1 day's 1,000 years with the Lord. 1,000 years is 1 day. Fourth day. The sun shined. The moon came in existence, and the stars began to shine. You know what happened on the 4,000th year of human history? The S-O-N came to this world. As the S-U-N of righteousness. 4,000 years after the creation of Adam and Eve, Jesus Christ, God Himself, showed up in person in the form of flesh. You know what happened when Jesus showed up in the form of flesh? On the fourth day, He started the church. You know what the church is? It's a reflection of the Son. You know what we as Christians are? We are a reflection of the Lord Jesus Christ. And He created the stars. You go to the book of Daniel, the Bible said, he that will many to righteousness shall shine as the brightness of the firmament forever and ever. You got it? Jesus showed up on the fourth day of creation. 4,000 years. One day is with the Lord is 1,000 years. 1,000 years is one day. Coincidence? I don't think so. Then on the fifth day of creation, the Bible tells us here that in verse 14, no, I'm sorry, that was the stars and the moon, and when he created the stars, the moon, and the church. By the way, they were soul winning because of separation. But when God created the church, you know what he commissioned the church to do? You preach the gospel to every creature. Soul winning really kicked in gear then when he created the church. I can go back and show you the book of Galatians where the Bible said the entire world had heard the gospel by the first church. Isn't that glorious?
Yes, sir.
Without microphone, without internet, without television, without radio, the entire world heard the gospel. You said, well, Mark, this ain't because somebody fumbled the ball. You hear me? The gospel was given, but somebody failed to carry it on and do what God wanted us to do and carry out the Great Commission. You go to verse 21, it talks about the fifth day of creation. That gives you the position of the church. Bible said he created the whales in the sea and the ocean, the fowls that fly in the air. You know what the position of the church? Hey, how many of you like fish? How many of you like ocean fish? Hot dog, I tell you, we go to Captain D's all the time. Now listen, that fish is in the salty sea, but the salt. The position of the church. We are in this world, but the world is not in us. And then the fowls. Where are they? They're flying above the earth. That don't mean that we're better than anybody else. That means we are heavenly people.
Amen.
And Lord, act like heavenly people. And then let's get good on the sixth day of creation. One day is with the Lord. How long? How long? So, on the sixth day of creation, that's 6,000 years from the time that Adam and Eve was created in the Garden of Eden, the Bible said God made man in his own image. We lost that image when Adam fell. I heard a statement made the other day by, I think it was Charles Spurgeon. He said this. He said, I'm a nobody. You're a nobody. He said, our father was a gardener, and he lost that position by stealing fruit from his master. And you think that over. He's talking about Adam. We are a bunch of nobodies, but thank God he saved us.
Amen.
And thank God one of these days we're going to be created. That image that Adam lost for us, we're going to gain it back. The Bible tells us in 1 John chapter 1, I think it's verse 2, it does not yet appear what we shall be. But we know this, when it shall appear, we shall be like him.
Amen.
For we shall see him as he is.
Yes, sir.
Oh, I would to God today that I could be more like Christ than I am, but one of these days, we're going, that image is going to come back to us. Amen. Everything that Adam lost, we're going to gain again. That brings us to the seventh day of creation. What did God do? He rested on the seventh day. You know what's going to happen over the seventh year, 7,000 year of human history? If I'm preaching correctly today, it's going to be a millennium. And during that millennium, 1,000 years, there's going to be peace on this earth. Earth is, isn't it glorious? First Bible lesson gives us the plan of salvation, how to get saved, how to go to heaven. All the way takes us to the millennium reign of Christ. Let's go to the second lesson I want to talk to you about right quick. That's the first miracle that Jesus performed. Now go to John chapter 2. John chapter 2. We're still talking Bible prophecy. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
One day is what? For more than 1,000 years. Now listen, in John chapter 2 and verse 1, the Bible said, in the third day, there was a marriage. How long Jesus been gone back to heaven? 2,000 years. One day's 1,000 years, 1,000 years is one day. You know how long that was in heaven? 2 days. Watch it. And then the third day, there was a marriage. Guess what's going to happen when Jesus Christ comes back? It's going to be the marriage supper of the Lamb. Why did he say after one day there was a marriage, or 5 days there was a marriage? Why did he say 2 days? Hey, he's giving us a message that believe the Bible, amen, that the words are skimmed right over, you can't even see. There was a marriage. Jesus attended that marriage. Hallelujah. And Matthew chapter 17, verse 1. Hey, I told you, read words. Read words. The Bible says after 6 days, Jesus was transfigured. What did they mean, transfigured? They saw his glory. After how many days? 6 days. One day is with the Lord, 1,000 years, 1,000 years in one day. 6,000 years. Hey, we're right there.
Amen.
You know what they did? Matthew chapter 17. They saw his glory. They saw him transfigured. They saw the light shining through his body. The true light. Back over to Genesis chapter 1 and verse 3. That by the third man becoming into the world. I don't know about you, but these little numbers that God puts in there is not accidental.
Amen.
God put them in there just for us. Hey, folks. The world reads that and thinks nothing about it. There was a reason why God said 2 days and 6 days. Luke chapter 10, verses 30 through 36. That's the parable of the Good Samaritan. A man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho. Hey, that's the type of being born in innocence. Jerusalem. Jericho is the place of sin under the curse of God. Then we reach the age of accountability. And we die spiritually under the curse of God. The Bible said on his way down, he fell among thieves. You know, if you're not saved this morning, there's thieves out here that's going to try to rob you of everything you've got.
Amen.
The Bible said, and they stripped him and left him half dead. He was alive spirit, alive physically, but dead spiritually. Laying in a ditch, helpless. Long came a Levite, looked at him. He said, I can't help you. That Levite represents the law. Law can't save us.
Right.
Then along came a priest. He walked over to where his dad looked at him and turned around and walked away. Religion can't help us.
Right. Amen.
But then there came on that day a good Samaritan.
Amen.
That good Samaritan represents Jesus.
Amen.
Now listen, the Bible said he went to where he was.
Amen.
When we couldn't go to him, he came to us.
Amen.
And the Bible said he bound up his wounds, pouring in oil and wine, oil representing the Holy Ghost, wine representing the blood. Then he put him on his own beast and he carried him to an inn. The inn represents the church. And when he departed, the Bible said he took out 2 pence and gave to the innkeeper. And said, whatsoever you spend more, when I return, I will repay you. You know what 2 pence are? 2 days' pay. That inn represents the church. God said, I've given you pay for 2 days. How long has it been gone, folks? 2,000 years. Are you following the scripture right now? Are you understanding where we're coming from on this scripture? Folks, I believe the coming of the Lord is near. 2 pence representing 2 days' pay. John chapter 2 and verse 5. Go back to our Mary's Supper in Galilee. Mary, the mother of Jesus, went to him and said, they don't have any wine. He said, what about them? Do they want? Then she looked at the servants, now listen to me, and said, whatsoever he saith unto you, do it. You get that? Let's correct the doctrine here. Mary didn't stay perfect as a virgin.
Right.
Mary is not holy.
Right.
Mary had to be saved just like you and I had to be saved. She had to be saved by trusting Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And she didn't say, I'm somebody. She said, He's somebody. Whatever He says,
yes,
you do it. And you know the story. The Bible said there were six water pots there. And these water pots were for the purification of the Jews. For purification. Hey, they were empty because they had to fill them with water. What does that tell you? That tells me that ritual and religion is empty. It takes Jesus.
Amen.
He said, fill them with water. And then he said, go out. And the Bible said, when they drew out the water, they gave it to the ruler that day. And he said, I've never tasted anything like this. Most people say that give the best at first, and then later on they serve the worst. But he said, you waited for now to serve the best. Let me stop here. Let me correct an error. That was non-alcoholic.
Right.
Worked that quite on that one, didn't he?
Amen.
You say, how do you know it was non-alcoholic? Because the book of Proverbs says in Proverbs 23, verse 31, look not thou upon the wine when it's red, when it giveth its color in the cup, when it moveth itself aright. You know what I'm saying? If it's fermented, don't even look at it. Much less drink it. Now, you better hear your preacher. If Jesus had given them fermented wine that they could have got drunk on, he would have been violating the Scripture.
That's right.
And had he violated the Scripture, he'd been a sinner.
Amen.
The book of Habakkuk said, don't you put the bottle to your neighbor's lips till they get drunk, and also warn to the man that does that. Jesus will not violate the Scripture. You say, well, why in the world did they call it wine, preacher? In the book of Isaiah, chapter 65, verse 8, listen. The Bible said, thus saith the Lord, that's Jehovah God. He said, as the new wine is in the cluster. Where's the new wine come from?
Grape.
Cluster. You know what a cluster is? It's a cluster of grapes.
Right.
It was grape juice.
Yeah.
But it was the best grape juice that a boy ever had.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
So got that settled? Is that settled in your mind?
Yeah.
I hope so. John chapter 2, verse 9. The Bible said when the ruler tasted that, he didn't know where it came from. But they hear suspicion. I want you to sit here. But the Bible said, but the servants knew. It was Jesus that had supplied. The ruler didn't know, but the servants knew. You know what we are? As your pastor pointed out to me this morning, as soon as we last, we're God's servants.
Amen.
The servants know. The servants stole the things of the Scripture that the world does not know. The servants stole about the death, the burial, the resurrection of Jesus Christ. You say, what's the big deal? Folks, if he didn't resurrect, he's no different from Mohammed, no different from Confucius, no different from any of these false gods. You know what they've got in common? They died, they rotted. They stayed in the grave. Jesus died his 3 days, 3 nights, his flesh and he was in corruption.
Yeah.
I tell you what you did. You let up. I preached the funeral of a woman was dead about 3 or 4 days. We carried her to the cemetery. Let me tell you what the undertaker told me. He said, don't walk too close behind that casket, preacher. He said, the smell is terrible. She'd been dead and laying in the living room floor for about 3 or 4 days. Jesus was dead, laid in a hot tomb for 3 days and 3 nights. His body saw no corruption. Why? He has a perfect, holy body.
Yes.
No sin in him.
Amen.
If he laid in that thing 3 years, he wouldn't have corrupted. There's no corruption in him. Hallelujah. That's my Savior.
Amen.
But he came out.
Yes,
he came out.
Amen.
He is alive. That's the, how do you know you've got the gospel? I'm preaching about the man that conquered death, hell, and the grave.
Amen.
He's the only one that ever did it.
Yes,
hallelujah. He had to be resurrected. The Bible said the servants knew. We know the story, don't we? We know the power of the gospel, don't we? We know the commission of the gospel. Go into all the world and preach the gospel every day. Don't we know that? Don't we know why the church left us here? We are to reflect the light of the sun. We are the moon. We are the light of the world. Oh, Jesus is in heaven. We know it because we're his servants. Now, if you go down to verse 16, John chapter 2, the Bible says the servants knew where the wine came from. But then the Bible said that Jesus, in John chapter 2 and verse 12, after this, after that wedding ceremony, the Bible said they went down to Capernaum. He and his mother and his brethren and his disciples, and they continued there many days. He went, his mama went, the disciples that was with Jesus went, his brethren went, the servants didn't go. Am I preaching to people today? We've got the truth in our hands. We've got the truth that will set people free, set the captive free. We've got in our hands the power of the gospel of Jesus Christ that will keep people out of hell. But the servants didn't go. Wonder how many of God's servants are there not going. Wonder how many of God's servants are there not busy engaged in doing the will of God. You want those servants. God help us so many times. Your pastor admitted so many times. He failed so many times. I failed. But we know, don't we? We know the truth. Are we doing what God wants us to do? Are we telling others? Are we engaged in worldwide missions? Are we engaged in giving the scripture to people that's never heard the scripture? I'm a member of the board of directors of the Bible Missionary Foundation, Shelbyville, Tennessee. Hey, we have sent millions and millions and millions of Bibles to 135 different nations, and some of them have never had a copy of the Bible in their life, in their hand, free of charge to the missionary. What a ministry. Getting out the Word of God. Victory Baptist Church. Victory Baptist Church supports a television ministry in Bangalore, India, that's reaching between 30 and 40 million people, 5 days a week. We support it. Send money over there for that television program, 30 minutes a day, 5 days a week. Isn't that glorious? $800 is all it costs, 5 days a week for a month. Folks, what are we doing? We know we're the servants, but are we going? Are we doing? Are we obeying? Or we just have that knowledge and we're holding it within our hearts? I asked you that question this morning. Are we doing what God's